live tonight on Saturday Fight Night, world title action. And it's the night Michael Brodie's been waiting for. After winning British, Commonwealth and European titles, is he ready now for the big one, a world title belt? Californian Willie Jorrin is the man standing in his way, also unbeaten, and another who's worked his way up to the biggest fight of his career.
Oh, crunching right hand. Now this is a man with tremendous spirit, fire and heart.
They meet tonight for the vacant WBC World Super Bantamweight crown. And there's more title action. A.D. Lewis may be short in stature, but the mighty Atom has already won British and Commonwealth titles in two weight divisions. And he defends both his bantamweight titles tonight. And then there's the showman, Bobby Vanzie, a dual champion at lightweight, unpredictable and flashy, but he gets the job done. Tonight he defends his Commonwealth lightweight title and his unbeaten record. Three title fights, but the top of the bill for the WBC World Super Bantamweight crown. The city of Manchester has been waiting for this one as Michael Brodie bids tonight to become the first of the city's young stars to make it to the very top and a world title. It could be a memorable night. Jim and Barry know all too well what Brodie will go through over the next few hours. After all, they did make the step and they did become world champions. Is this the hardest moment of his career, Barry, waiting to go in for a world title?
Without a doubt. This guy is another level up to anybody he's fought before. Willie Jorrin is a tremendous young fighter, unbeaten, which is a great thing to take, very confident, but it's a great stroke for Michael to have got this fight at home. He will need all of the partisan support that he's got. It's a 50-50 fight, but I think he can do it, and it's going to be very tough.
Jim, it's been a superb record on the way up, a perfect record on the way up, but it's not just about what he's done tonight. He's got to show something extra on this occasion, surely.
Yeah, definitely. One of the things that worries me about Michael throughout his career, a couple of fights he's gone to sleep. He seems to have lost his confidence. He can't afford to do that at this level. This is, as Barry says, up another level. And this little fella, this looks like a distance fight, so we're looking for 12 rounds of concentration from Michael.
Word is a tough opponent in Jorrin from Sacramento in California. He's made the right impression so far, certainly. 26 straight wins. He knows his job, fought plenty of top men, but he is 4 years older than Brodie. And Brodie, patient, who's built his record slowly so far, but very much in the spotlight. Is he comfortable? We have two genuine contenders, and this is the night we find out.
It's going to be a great fight. I know Michael Brodie comes to fight, and we're going to put on an excellent show, and be looking at the next WBC world champ.
No matter what, I've trained hard, and I'm ready. I'm focused. I'm going to win the world title, believe me.
The city of Manchester's longing for another sporting star. One set of local heroes at Old Trafford were at it again today with a comfortable victory over Sunderland. We are just down the road from the famous stadium tonight, and plenty of the crowd have moved on from the game to the fight. It's bowlers tonight here. We have had some memorable nights here, but for Manchester and Brodie, they hope this is the best yet.
Oh yeah, superb. He's come up the hard way. He's won everything in front of him, so I'm just hoping he can get this way and get the final title.
Yeah, he's waited a long time for this fight. He's full of confidence, and he'll do him in four rounds. We've had a good bet of him in the fourth round.
Top guys, nicest bloke you'd ever meet.
It's great, isn't it? Because like, there's nothing really special only from Manchester United, and it's great. It's great for Manchester boxing.
Big one coming later tonight, but first tonight live, the British and Commonwealth bantamweight title defence by A.D. Lewis. Now, Jim, he may not be the most fashionable fighter in Britain, but there are only a couple in the history of the game who've done what this boy has done already. Is it about time he took a turn in the spotlight himself?
Yeah, well, I think so, yeah. I mean, we don't know how far he can take himself. He's won good domestic titles already at two weights. Whether he'll move on to world honours, we don't know. But the thing is, he has to pay the bills, so what he has to do here is defend his title, earn some money. On paper, this looks like a fight he should definitely win, but he still has the job to do. He still has to get in there and get the job done against a little fellow who's only lost one fight and who will surely be up for the task.
Tommy Waite, a big outsider here, Barry. What's his best chance of an upset?
Well, his best chance is to stay on the outside. He's a switch hitter. Try and keep little lady at arm's length. box him, move from side to side, switch him, confuse him, and stay on the outside. But as Jim says, you've got to make Eddie a strong favourite here. He's gone the distance many times in long, arduous fights, and he looks to have the upper hand.
Superb lineup of action coming tonight for you. We have a very big crowd here in Boulders tonight. It will be very, very noisy here later on. Our team at ringside, all set to go. Adam Smith, joined by the former European super bantamweight champion Spencer Oliver, and we'll hear from them later at the top of your screen there. But it's Glenn McCrory and Ian Dark for commentary after our master of ceremonies, John McDonald.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's championship boxing. Please welcome to the ring now, from Belfast, Northern Ireland, Tommy Waite.
Well, here's Tommy Waite, the former fruit and veg seller from the Shankill Road in Belfast. Not very many people fancy his chances. And one of the big minuses, really, for him going into this fight is he cuts so often in his fights, Glenn.
Well, that's a big problem to have, but this is it's a big fight for him. You can guarantee, you know, he'll be at his best, and you can expect him to have a better performance than ever before. But that is the problem, the fact that he cuts, and also he's not a big puncher, so he's got to try and outbox Lewis.
This chance arriving in his 12th fight. He's won 10 out of 11 so far. Few of them have been pretty debatable decisions, I have to tell you, but an eye-catching one was the victory over Vince Feeney, which has basically earned him his chance. Some people debated that one. Doesn't matter, he's had a proper preparation for this fight. He says for the first time, and he thinks he can cause the upset. Well, let's see if he can.
And ladies and gentlemen, welcome the champion, the mighty atom, Eddie Lewis.
Just 4 feet, 10.5 inches tall. Little Eddie Lewis, a British and Commonwealth champion at flyweight and bantamweight. Only Jackie Patterson and Walter McGowan have ever done that in the past, so it's a real achievement. And he was as sharp as tacks last time against Francis Ampopo. It's a pity that the town he comes from, Bury, near here, has banned boxing.
Well, it's unbelievable when he's done so well, and you know, he really has done well. And you know, he's got to, you know, you expect him to fight very well here. This is a style, I think, with that will suit him, and I think he looked good here.
British and Commonwealth Bantamweight Championship then. Let's check the statistics here, Lewis. The champion is 3 years younger than Tommy Waite. And Waite, although he's only 5'4", he's almost got a 6-inch height advantage. That can't have happened before. Both inside the 8-stone, 6-pound limit. Reach advantage for Waite, as you'd expect. Can he make it count? He's quite a nimble boxer. Debut for Waite in 96, Lewis in 94. Eddie Lewis more experienced and at a higher level, and he will be the one with the extra power here.
Ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening and welcome to Bowlers Leisure Centre here in the double premiership city of Manchester, England. Ringside Boxing Promotions proudly present the British and Commonwealth Bantamweight Championship. Sponsored here by Dome Bookmakers and live and exclusive here on Sky Sports, you've joined us for the very best ringside seat in the business. All the officials have been appointed by the British Boxing Border Control and Commonwealth Council here present with us at ringside, matchmaker Mr. Graham Lockwood. Steward in charge, His Honour Alan Simpson. A representative is Mr. Dennis Lockton. Timekeeper at the bell from the still city of Sheffield, Mr. Barry Pinder. And referee in charge of the action from London, Mark Green. Well, they are the officials, and here are the contestants. Firstly, and introducing to you the challenger. He's fighting out of the red corner. He's wearing the blue trunks trimmed with red and white, and weighed in at 8 stone, 5 pounds, 14 ounces. bringing an 11 fight record, 10 wins, 3 inside the scheduled distance, and 1 defeat. Coming to the ring as the All Ireland Bantamweight Champion from Belfast, Northern Ireland, Tommy Waite. And ladies and gentlemen, the champion, he's fighting out of the blue corner. He's wearing a black trunks and weighing in at 8 stones, 4¾ pounds, and bringing a 21 fight record. 18 wins, 12 inside the scheduled distance, 2 losses and 1 draw. He comes to the ring as the former British and Commonwealth flyweight champion. He's making the first defense of the British and Commonwealth bantamweight title. Would you please welcome the champion from Bury, the mighty Atom, Lewis. Well, sports fans and Sky fans, let's get the action underway then. 12 rounds of boxing for the British and Commonwealth bantamweight championship.
Remember, protect yourselves at all times and respect each other at all times. Shake hands, good luck.
Lewis confident about retaining his titles here. Usually a pressure fighter, this fellow Waite, neat, nimble, switch hitter, but not a big puncher. Comes from the Barry Hearn camp, Tommy Waite, the Irish champion, in the purple trunks here, the black of little A.D. Lewis, the so-called mighty Atom, who holds these British and Commonwealth bantamweight crowns. Last time out against Ampofa, we saw something we've never seen before from Lewis. He was using slick boxing tactics, and they were the right tactics for Ampofa, but they won't be the right tactics tonight. He'll go hunting here.
Well, already Lewis is pushing very hard, and he's catching away with some sharp punches.
Oh, big left hook. And that one definitely had its effect from Lewis. He got one into the body, then to the head as well.
Well, Waite has to try and tighten up with his defence. He's been caught by too many shots too early.
This is a big step up in one jump for Tommy Waite. Much more dedicated these days. A.D. Lewis wants to take his career somewhere, and he's still only 25. It's another right hand this time that gets through and rocks back the head of Waite. Reasonable combinations from the challenger. And has he got the power to make Lewis think on the way in?
Oh, it's trying to get his jab working, trying to get out of range, but again he gets picked up with those left hooks from Lewis.
Lewis, who's won 18 out of 21, only a couple of defeats. Good head movement from him, rolling, making himself an elusive target and getting there again with those hooks. Waite needs a bit more of that head movement himself, doesn't he, at this stage?
Yes, he does. I think it really is a problem for Waite when somebody as small as A.D. Lewis is beating him to the jab. You know, he really should be getting off Waite quicker and catching Lewis on the way in.
Has to be really neat and nimble, and bags of movement. That's what Waite needs. And when he gets some of those combinations to get away again, stand in front of A.D. Lewis, who's got a big edge and power over him, and there he gets through again, body and headshot, easily the champion's opening round so far, and pretty impressively too. He doesn't want to be taking this many, Tommy Waite.
Again, good solid jab from A.D. Lewis, and this has been a really big round for him. Looking good, nice body punch.
Once or twice, some neat little interludes from Waite himself, but that's definitely the champion's opening session. Some blood from his nose, mind you, in that first round. Many, many more landed by Eddie Lewis, who had a 50% success rate, Glenn.
Yes, he did. He landed well. He came in, good head movement, and then got the jab working well and the hooks. And there he is, just doubling up body and head. And that was an excellent combination from Lewis. The right hand working. He really started very well indeed. Got to his rhythm, and the style just suits him, I think. And he really is nice and relaxed, and you're getting these punches off very well.
By the way, Tommy Waite boxing here after a broken right ankle with 10 screws in the right ankle, two pins and one plate. He got past the doctor, but I'm not sure about the metal detector. Purple trunks of the challenger from Belfast, Tommy Waite. He's got a lot of his family here watching him on this, the biggest night of his boxing career. He'll need to improve on that first round, that's for certain. He could possibly do that. Sometimes fighters freeze a little early on when they get their big chance.
But it's a problem for Waite if he's going to get hit a lot. Oh, they were nice.
Good sharp shots, and he looked disorganized for a moment there, Eddie Lewis. The gloves went down, and that was encouraging for Waite.
Well, this is different now from Waite. Now Waite has started to stand his ground, looking to attack. And when he does that, his sharp punches had an effect on Lewis.
They certainly did. Real encouragement for the challenger there. Pretty classy boxing too.
Looks tiny sign of a nick on the nose of Tommy Waite.
Has to be careful with cuts. He's been cut in 7 of 11 fights, an awful lot. Again, fast punches and away. He's not standing there quite as much as he was in that first round. Has to keep this up.
Well, I think the thing that he's doing better is he's trying to get set himself and let his punches off before he moves. And he's having a much better effect when he does that.
Excellent so far for Tommy Waite in the second round until that right hand just landed. And I do believe he touched down. I think he'll have to take account for that. It was only a flash knockdown. He just touched down with the glove. A pin, he was doing so well in the round, but that was an excellent right hand from Eddie Lewis. That turns it again.
Well, I think because of the styles in this fight, this is really warming up to be a very good one.
Certainly is so far, with the plot thickening. From Tommy Waite in this second round. He's missing quite a lot, Eddie Lewis, but he's landed the big punch that's mattered in the round. That's excellent. Again, the right hand just seemed to stagger Lewis a little, didn't it? Seemed to go through to his legs.
Yes, that's a couple of times that's happened. The punch power of Waite has had an effect on Lewis when he puts his shots together.
That's surprising. Waite's only ever had 3 inside schedule wins. He wouldn't claim to be a big puncher himself. Blood from the nose still of Eddie Lewis. This could be a little tougher though than some people might have imagined. Well, there was a knockdown in that round, but I've not scored that a 10-8 round. No way to Eddie Lewis. It was only a flash knockdown, but I think you've got to give him the session, haven't you, on the basis of that?
You do. You've got to give him the session. It was a very good punch, and that just gave him the better effect in that round. Couldn't quite see it from that angle, but I think we'll see it better here. There's the hand going down, and yep, a definite touchdown. But as you see, and he didn't do enough to get a 10-8 round. Wasn't big enough for Lewis to merit that, but you'd have to give him a 10-9. And this is later on, and you just see Waite having some effect himself. The combination there, the final right hand was the one that rocks the legs.
Good refereeing by Mark Green to pick up the knockdown. Here's the third round, the champion Eddie Lewis in the black trunks from Bury in Lancashire. And Tommy Waite from the famous fight city of Belfast. There have been a few Belfast fighters who've been in for these titles before down the years. Freddie Gilroy, Johnny Caldwell, among others. Again, that right hand that did the damage in the second round from Lewis.
Well, it certainly looks Lewis is the harder single punch hitter, but Waite can connect and can hurt Lewis when he puts his combinations together.
Just mixing it up a little more. 80 Lewis now.
Well, I think Lewis maybe forgot the head movement a bit in the second round because of his good start. Needs to get back to that.
Bit low with the right hand, but certainly well on the target area with the following left hook, AD Lewis. Fights out of the Jack Doughty camp. A bit too easy to hit to the head. Waite.
Well, Lewis has to continue to roll. He's got to keep that rhythm, keep them punches going. When he does that, he looks good.
And shouting that to Waite. Move the head. Jerry Story in the corner. They've picked up on it too. That's better. Reflexes were good then. Good action, Glenn.
Very good action. And we're finding that Waite not moving as much as he was, being forced to stand and trade with Lewis somewhat, and you know, maybe that doesn't suit him.
Well, maybe he's trying to give AD Lewis something that he wouldn't be expecting, but it may not be his best game plan. We've seen Lewis just stunned a couple of times, haven't we, and looking disorganized.
Yes, we have. I mean, he can't afford to be caught by combinations from Waite. He needs to keep rolling, needs to keep that head on the move.
Good right uppercut, but look at that by Waite. Great skills, the way he turned AD Lewis on that far side. Coming up to the end of the third round in this excellent fight so far. Switch hitting there from Waite for these British and Commonwealth Bantamweight Championships.
How you doing, sir? You got any ham in your hamburgers?
No, we don't. We have pure 100% beef.
Why didn't you have ham in your hamburger?
You don't want ham in our hamburgers. You don't want our hamburgers? You can go someplace.
Why do you call it a hamburger?
Just call it a hamburger because it's a hamburger.
You want another contradiction? Bud Light. It's premium lager, but at the same time, lower calorie.
I believe that.
So there's no ham in a burger, so it's false advertising.
No, it's not false advertising.
It is.
I'll tell you what.
I want a
hamburger. I'll give you the hamburger.
What's in your hot dogs?
Sunday night from 9 on Sky Sports 1. Seattle Seahawks against the St. Louis Rams, the current Super Bowl champions. Live from the Husky Stadium, 9, Sunday night on Sky Sports 1. We're in Manchester live tonight for Michael Brodie's world title bid coming later. But Lewis and Waite providing a fine show opener for us here. Back to Glenn and Ian.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Paul. Fourth round coming up. I think AD Lewis has probably won everything so far, but that really doesn't tell the story of how well Tommy Waite has done. He's got to do better though, hasn't he? Even better.
Yes, he's got to just pick it up more. He's got to start keeping these combinations going and add a bit more to them. He's just letting Lewis get off first, and Lewis dominate a little bit more than him.
Again, choosing to stand right in front of AD Lewis and try to match him punch for punch. Lewis certainly isn't going to have to go looking for him in the way that he might have imagined.
Well, maybe this is a sign that Waite doesn't feel that Lewis is as strong as he thought he would be.
That's a lovely punch, just two or three of them there from Tommy Waite. He's certainly got a classy stamp about him. That was a low blow this time from Lewis, the champion. Over in Belfast, Tommy Waite's been working with some decent power merchants, the lightweight Michael Ayres and featherweight Richard Evatt.
Well, they are strong men, and that should have really toughened them up, but still getting caught a bit too much.
Just a bit more lateral movement you feel might help Waite.
Yes, he's solid enough, Waite, but he just hasn't got that roll and that rhythm. But it's not all going Lewis's way. He's having to take a few himself.
Pretty tough battle, matching each other almost punch for punch in this fourth round. He's a little more ragged with his work, Lewis, in the last half minute or so. Some facial damage as well now for AD Lewis, beginning to develop one or two little blemishes and nicks. And there's one by the right eye. It's more than a nick, in fact. It's opened right up. It's opened right up. There was a nick there. Now it's a more serious cut for AD Lewis. Well, this is trouble, Glenn.
It is trouble. I think, you know, he's just been hit more in this round, Lewis.
It's over. He's lost his titles on a cut in the fourth round. One or two protests from Jack Doughty. The referee has called off the fight. They're protesting about it. We've got controversy here. He thinks he could have gone on, and that argument is carrying on. But it means that Tommy Waite, the man who suffered cuts so often himself in the past, has won the British and Commonwealth Bantamweight Championships on a cut. Here's another thing, Glenn. If this had been a world championship fight, the rules now say there have to be four completed rounds, otherwise it's a technical draw.
They don't do that in Britain. And I think Eddie Lewis is very, very unfortunate. He's angry, he's really upset, and I think he has a right. I think the referee could have let him go on a bit longer, could have given the corner a chance to work on that cut. You know, he's a double champion, and they've taken it away from him in one swoop.
They never even let them work on the cut. And I mean, surely the referee should have let them work for a while.
Definitely.
And then had a look at it at the end of the minute.
That was my point. He should have let them go on, just see out the round, give them a chance to work on it. You know, remember, Eddie Lewis is a double champion. He's a double champion. His title, you know, they've really given the champion no leeway whatsoever.
It was a bad-looking cut. There's the man in the centre of this, Mark Green. There's a row going on about this. You do feel sorry for AD Lewis. It's a pity. It was such a good fight till then.
Yeah, it's a big, big shame. I mean, Tommy Waite was doing better in this round. He was standing still. He was getting his punches off. But look at AD Lewis's face. He's worked so hard for these titles, and he's just had them taken away from him, and he's devastated.
Jack Doughty's not happy. The conversation going on with the referee. You do understand that frustration. I don't think that's unreasonable, really, in a championship fight. I mean, if at the end of the minute they'd done some patch-up work and it still looked horrible, I guess they'd have to say, you know, that's it, it's over. But it was unsatisfactory. There's got to be a rematch of this, you'd think, the way this has ended.
Most definitely. It's not a good ending, and Eddie Lewis has a right to be very upset.
Here it is officially, anyway, from the MC.
Ladies and gentlemen, timekeeper Barry Pinder has recorded a time of 2:08 of the fourth round. Referee Mark Green has stopped the contest. Unfortunately, Lewis has sustained a cut. Cannot continue. Your winner and the new British and Commonwealth Bantamweight champion from Belfast, Northern Ireland, Tommy Waite. And please show your appreciation for a very, very game champion indeed, AD Lewis. To present the championship belt to call upon His Honour, Alan Simpson, our supervisor.
Well, you can never complain about a lack of stories in this business. There's always something turning up.
Yes, there is. But, you know, I mean, it was unfair. I mean, the referee, obviously, he's the man in the ring. He's got to judge. He's got to see how bad it is. But, it had just opened. It wasn't impairing the vision with the blood. There was no immediate distress. They should have, you know, he's got good cutmen in his corner, Eddie Lewis. They should have given him the chance as the champion to go back and see what the corner could do with that cut. and that you give the corner a chance.
Having said that, it was a good effort from Tommy Waite. We think he was behind in the fight, but he was certainly making a good argument of it. Who knows, he might have gone on to win. We'll never know that. But anyway, let's join Adam Smith. I'd be interested to hear what A.D. Lewis has got to say about this. Over to you, Adam.
Well, A.D., it's happened again to you. It happened with Noel Wilders when you were stopped by a cut. Now, what about that one? Obviously, you're furious. They had no time to work on it.
Once again, it was class events. Once again, it's not even bleeding now. You look at the cameras now, and it's not even bleeding now. If we had a more experienced referee, maybe they'd let it go. And I think I deserve a return for that.
You think you were well in control? It was a good fight, wasn't it?
Round. I knocked him down. That's a two-point round to start off with, and I won every round anyway, I think, in my eyes. I was working him over, I would have stopped him.
How bad do you think it is?
How bad do I think the cut is? I can't see. I can't look at myself, but from what people tell me, it's stopped bleeding now. It's not even going down my eye now. And it's up to my manager, Tommy Gilmore, to get me rematch.
Let's bring Tommy in. What do you think about that referee stoppage?
I think it's absolutely deplorable that an A-star referee didn't give the corner an opportunity to work in it. We've got Benny King, one of the top cut men in the country. We've seen what he's done in the past to help people, bleeders like Charlie Shepherd, and yet he's never been given the opportunity. I think that the board have got an inexperienced referee who should be told that you've got to give the corner an opportunity to work. Otherwise, there's no point in us putting top quality men in.
You're demanding
in the
a rematch.
I've got an option on Tommy Waite, and I'll be exercising it.
AD, an awful way to lose your titles, but you'll be back.
I'll be back, don't worry about that. I'll be back. Like you see, Liz, I know I can beat him. I know Tommy's going to get me a rematch, so I'm going to beat him next time. I would have won this time, but what can I do?
Thanks very much, Eddie.
When a man works as hard as a man like Lewis must work to become a double champion, that is a pernicious, cruel way to lose, isn't it, Barry?
Yeah, it's an awful... but look, it has happened before. We had young Damien Kelly in boxing, Keith Knox, who was Tommy's fighter, so he's on the other side of the scale this time.
I mean, the promoters never get hurt. You know that by now, don't you?
Of course. The point I'm making is that it can happen, and he should have a chance to have a rematch. And it's not Tommy Waite's fault, and he fought very well. He came back into the fight, he boxed very well, and it was an unfortunate clash of heads. He didn't do it deliberately. He's not a wicked, mendacious sort of a character.
We'll look at that in just a moment or two, Barry, but I think we've got the winner at ringside here. Let's hear from Tommy Waite.
Well, Tommy, congratulations. You win the titles, but was it fair?
Well, on the cuts it was fair, because opened him up with a shot at it. It wasn't close ahead or anything, and it was up their referee who stopped it, not me.
Do you personally think they should have had a chance to work on it?
Yeah, maybe a round or so, but that's the way it goes when you're refereeing.
It was a great scrap, wasn't it? It was turning into a really hot affair.
First couple of rounds, it was just starting to get it, let him do his work first, and then I'd come in there, because it takes me a couple of rounds to get going.
Bring your manager Barry Hearn in. Well, Barry, Tommy Gilmore wants a rematch. He's furious.
Tommy's, I think, entitled to be furious. I think we'd have wanted another round at least for the corner to do his work. You know, we can't criticise the boxers, and there's no point in criticising the referee because his decision is final. If it had been the other way around, I would have been furious, the same as Tommy Gilmore. And I think the fairest way is to get these two together again in the ring, although this time it's Belfast.
And you'll be happy with that.
No problem.
Yeah. Well done, Tommy, tonight. Take the belts home.
Thank you.
Nobody begrudges Waite his moment in the spotlight. Very gifted amateur he was, and it took an awfully long time for any of it to come out in the pro ranks. But he's wrong. It was a clash of heads, Jim, wasn't it?
It was a clash of heads. I've got to be honest, I didn't spot it. When they came back up and replay, I didn't spot it until we saw the replay. But there's a little point you have to remember. It was a bad cut. Right, okay, it was a bad cut. And because corner men managed to stop the bleeding, that was definitely what caused the cut. Just a little trickle of blood, just as that happened. But again, accidental, totally accidental clash of it. As much, probably more A.D. Lewis's fault than Tommy Waite's. So it's one of these things that we have to put up with in the fight game. And as I was about to say, it was a bad cut. Criticising the referee, I think, is wrong, because a corner stopped the bleeding doesn't mean it's not a bad cut anymore. A referee has to think, where is that cut going to go in one or two more rounds? You can ruin a guy's career with a cut like that. At the moment, I'm sure the Board of Control will order an immediate rematch, and that is the only fair thing. You can't send that kid out with that cut eye again.
Told he'd be good tonight. Michael Brodie still to come bidding for a world title, but also here in Manchester we have Bobby Vanzie from Bradford, the British and Commonwealth lightweight champion, in action against Joseph Charles from Trinidad. This a defence of the Commonwealth title only for Vanzie. He's not exactly everybody's cup of tea. He is a showman, and he tends to win. Here's what happened earlier, watched by Jim with Adam Smith for commentary.
So, Bobby Vanzie, the eccentric, dazzling, sometimes frustrating British and Commonwealth lightweight champion, who, despite having two crowns, is still struggling for full recognition amongst the very top 9 stone 9 men. Here he makes the fourth defence of his Commonwealth belt against Trinidad's Joseph Charles, who's come in at short notice. He's won 10 of his 17, but is unknown on these shores. Never easy when neither man knows very much about the other.
No, I don't suppose, Adam, but I'm an old dinosaur. I mean, in my day, you very seldom saw film of your opponent anyway, so you just got all the tools ready and got on with the job. Bobby Vanzie, he's perfected a style all of his own. He's a good pro, so I'm sure he'll have done that. He'll have all the tools ready.
Yes, he has. Vanzie is an interesting fighter. Sometimes can look devastating. Ala Nassim Hamad, occasionally with those funny moves and angles, but often can just get stuck in that role a little bit as well. Depends which style he's fighting against. Sometimes Charles looks tall and rangy. Southport. He is coming off 3 defeats, but they were against good class lightweights, and Vanzie is one of those.
Well, first impressions of Charles, he doesn't look too bad. I don't know what kind of condition he's in. I would imagine he must have been training for some other fight if he's taken this one at short notice. But he moves around well, he's controlled. When Vanzie shows a little feint, he doesn't panic, and he's always ready to come back with counters. So, first impressions, he doesn't look too bad.
Looks in very good condition for a last minute opponent, Joseph Charles. It was going to be the South African Enoch Zifa. Vanzie just creeping in with an uppercut there. He's got power, Vanzie. Not sure quite how much. But in his last fight, he knocked Zambian super featherweight Paul Kaoma cold in 2 rounds. But he was a super feather.
Well, Vanzie just trying things out in the first round here. He realises he's against a man with a long reach who likes to use that reach. So his head movement's good. He's just having a good look. Probably just nicking around, being that little bit busier.
Yeah, it's just settling down. A little right again from Vanzie. Got a wobble from Charles, who has thin legs for his frame. Vanzie's opening round. The second in this Commonwealth lightweight title defence for Bradford's Bobby Vanzie, the 26-year-old in the silver trunks. Flashy and some say arrogant, certainly speaks his mind and wants fights with the top British lightweights, Michael Ayres, Billy Schwer and Colin Dunn. For the moment, he must deal with Joseph Charles, who he knows little about, from the West Indies. And he's having a good look at Vanzie.
I don't know that trying to beat Bobby Vanzie on your back foot's a good idea. He does so many unpredictable things. He's very quick, and as we've seen a couple of times, fairly powerful as well. So I think you really got to shut him down a little bit, try and come forward. So sooner or later, Charles is going to have to try that.
That's exactly what Stephen Smith tried to do earlier this year in a mauling, brawling fight with Vanzie. Trying to back Vanzie up with his southpaw style, but here's a southpaw that's fighting very much on the back foot. And Vanzie will relish that.
Yeah, well, Vanzie's forcing the action here. He's pushing him back without really working too hard. So it's a good start to a 12-rounder for Vanzie. 12 rounds is a long time, as we know. So he's not wasting too many punches.
Bobby. only needs to impress Vanzie. That good knockout win last time, but occasionally he gets floored and goes off the boil in the ring. Left hand success.
See, I think the problem for Vanzie in his career, he holds a British title, but the couple of guys look up well. I don't know if the referee's going, yep, he's calling that a knockdown, which is, I suppose, fair enough, but I think part of that was balance.
Yes, he was moving round and caught by the right of Vanzie. But Ian John Lewis calls it a knockdown. Remember, he scores this Commonwealth fight. So early success for Vanzie. Can he build on it? Charles was shaken in the first round by a couple of right uppercuts. But he does look like he's got a decent chin on paper. Only legitimately knocked out once. He was disqualified before. I think Vanzie feels he's got the power to finish this one within the distance.
Oh, another good right hook there just before the bell. I think Charles looks a little bit slow at the moment, but I think that's down to the fact that Vanzie is so quick and not really giving him a chance to land any punches.
He's a nightmare to fight, Vanzie.
Well, it's a style he's developed. Not everybody likes it, but he's developed it, he's worked at it. So maybe we'll see the knockdown. See, look at that. That really wasn't a punch. The punch caught him in the shoulder. That was more of a push, a stumble, and down he's gone. But we'll have to score at 10-8 because the referee... See, that's... I mean, no way can you call that a knockdown punch, but some good fortune for Bobby Vanzie.
And defended against Vincent Howard and Paul Kaoma. Now for Joseph Charles, who is finding little answer to the problems he's facing in Vanzie's style. Works the body. Well, he is negative, Joseph Charles, as he backs away.
The trouble then, Adam, he actually backed away for no reason. Vanzie was squatting in front of him trying to draw a lead. Instead of showing a little feint and trying to get Vanzie to come up himself, he just stepped back. I wonder maybe if he doesn't have the confidence over the distance being that he's taken the fight at short notice, but you would think he would have come out, had a few shoot or bust rounds, see maybe if he could spring a knockout or whatever, but good right hand from Vanzie, good punching.
Good combinations from Bobby Vanzie. And a knockdown is called by Ian John Lewis. Bobby Vanzie put that cluster together when he finished Stephen Smith. He's got very quick hand speed. We need to see more of that. When he has the man pinned on the ropes, that looks almost the best Bobby Vanzie.
Yeah, I think what I'd like to see him do is commit himself a little bit more. He's still... Nothing wrong with wanting to land punches without being hit back. Okay, that's the essence of boxing. But for excitement, he's going to have to step in to the lion's den, stay there and let some punches go. Be prepared to take something back. Because he punches harder than this guy, and this guy hasn't shown really anything to trouble Vanzie. I'd like to see him stand his ground and just be a bit more attractive.
He's jumping in with right uppercuts and left hands. A loud Bobby Vanzie hooter from the fans. Might remind you of Nassim Hamed, but Hamed, of course, has that concussive power. And Vanzie doesn't hold that.
But holding inside, I don't know who is the more guilty.
I think it was Charles. He's getting worked over by Vanzie. He's really just come here to walk through this, Joseph Charles. 3 points defeats in a row, lacking ambition. Right from Vanzie, as Charles tried to come in for a change. It might help Vanzie if that's what Charles did.
Yeah, well, Vanzie's a champion now, and the one building a career, wanting to be an attraction, just a little bit more of everything we want from him, but he's certainly hanging on to his title without a doubt.
Round after round for Bobby Vanzie. This was good.
Yeah, that was definitely a knockdown. Good burst of punches, and Charles actually was forced onto the floor just to get away from the punches. He couldn't slip them, couldn't block them, so he had to go down. And the rope actually stopped him from going all the way down, so technically that is a knockdown.
Unlike that was good
from, sorry, Adam, but that was good from Vanzie. If he would just pick up where he left off, stay in there. He has more power, more natural strength than this guy. I wish he would start using it, and then we could give us something to become excited about. Those were good shots, piling them on.
Really putting the meat into those, Vanzie.
This time, I've decided to go all the way and take my lashes to the limit.
Discover Longitude, L'Oreal's first ultra-lengthening mascara with Extencel technology. Longitude's extending polymer formula stretches right to the very end of each lash, giving you up to 30% visibly longer lashes.
Infinitely lengthened, beautifully separated, the lashes that go on forever. Take your lashes to the limit.
New Longitude mascara from L'Oreal.
L'Oreal, because I'm worth it.
Some final instructions from Godfrey Brown for the headshots. Fresh and quick to his feet, Bobby Vanzie for the sixth round of this Commonwealth lightweight title against the tall, rangy 31-year-old from Trinidad, Joseph Charles, who has not had much to offer, and Vanzie is wearing him down. He's fighting regularly, Bobby Vanzie, but the jury is still out. That's good. And a left to the body as well. Charles just sinks to his feet. Down for the third time in the fight. He might be starting to get fed up with this, Joseph Charles. He's taken it at 2 days' notice. I don't know if he really wants much more of it. Can Vanzie force the stoppage?
The big problem for Charles, he can't get himself into the fight. Nothing that he's done has had any impression whatsoever on Vanzie. Vanzie doing pretty much as he pleases. And now a couple of visits to the canvas can't have done much for his confidence.
Trying to unload single shots, Vanzie. From the strange angles. And letting Charles recover after each knockdown. And Joseph Charles' trainer, Cecil Ford, just watching in the corner. His expression hasn't changed in six rounds. I don't know what he tells his fighter in between them.
Good body shot, Adam. That'll maybe take another little bit of steam out of Charles. That was a nice little shot to the ribs then.
Again, trying to jump in, Vanzie. Hurl himself. Can he trap him on the ropes again? Charles looks unsteady on his feet. It could almost be curtains for the West Indian, if Vanzie increases the pace. Again, he just tumbles to the floor. I think we are not going to see much more from Mr. Charles. He's having a chat with the referee, and I think he's going to quit, is he? He's not happy. I don't know whether he thought he was caught low or... No, he has pulled out. Well, well. We see some strange endings in boxing. Joseph Charles had quite simply had enough. And Bobby Vanzie retains his Commonwealth lightweight title. 19 out of 20 for the Viper from Bradford. And please bring on Billy Schwer, Michael Ayres, Colin Dunn. One of those names we need to see Vanzie against now.
Yeah, but a more attractive opponent, he'll probably look better. Over the years, now and again, we have to criticise referees, but that was a nice bit of refereeing we've just seen then, because referee obviously realised that Charles was struggling, couldn't get himself into the fight, so he had a good chat with him, realised the kid wanted out of there, and got him out of there. He'd given his best, nothing, he was out of the fight, so as I say, a good bit of refereeing. See, at this stage, he couldn't get into the fight. Vanzie was doing pretty much as he pleased. I just wish at this stage if Vanzie had stood his ground and let bursts of punches go rather than that disjointed style that he sticks with, because he had a chance to look good at this stage. But nevertheless, I said if he stopped this fellow, it'd be a good result, and he did that, so it was a good result.
And down again here, Charles. Was he thrown in this one?
Yeah, that was just a stumble. Yeah, that was the. But that time his hat was out of the thing. He had nothing more to offer. And as I say, the referee realised that once again. Nice bit of refereeing.
Easy for Vanzie. And both decided enough was enough. Referee and opponent. Bobby Vanzie is the winner, but the jury still is out.
So, Barry, we get the idea. He's not in the running for Britain's best-loved boxing personality. Yeah. But that doesn't matter. The record now is 19 out of 20.
Yeah.
When is somebody going to say a word for Vanzie?
No, let me tell you something. He's awkwardly effective. Nobody wants to fight him. His style is not the most alluring or attractive, but he's very effective at what he does. He gets the job done, and the bottom line is he keeps winning. It was a bit untidy and messy at the finish, but the bottom line is he keeps winning.
A brief thought, Jim, you were close to it. Is he improving?
No, I don't think he's improving. I think he's taking his style as far as he can take it. And the only thing I get upset with Bobby, he could be so much better. He would deliver better punches if he improved his balance and got his technique. I don't want him to desert what he's been doing all these years, but add to it. Don't just keep doing it. The talent's there. Let it come through.
Now we focus on our top of the bill here tonight in Manchester. And we are really on the edge of our seats about this one as Michael Brodie bids to become a world champion. Done it all on the way up and in a very traditional manner. Adam Smith reporting.
Firstly British, then Commonwealth, and finally the European belt. Boxing's traditional route that has taken fighters like John Conti, Lloyd Hunnigan, and Lennox Lewis to world glory. Few follow the old school today, but 26-year-old Michael Brodie has made those three steps to heaven. In 97, he won the domestic and Commonwealth crowns. In 98, he achieved European glory. Brodie then waited patiently, defending five times at that level.
I've won the British outright. I've won the Commonwealth. I've won the European and defended it a few times. Now I think it's a step for me to go up to the world class.
It's been a long road. From the poor streets of Salford came a quiet, shy and unassuming young man. Michael Brodie has been carefully guided by manager Jack Trickett, who believes they've got the timing right.
He's dead ready for it now. He's well up for it. This is the natural progression. He'll win it.
World titles don't come much more prestigious than the WBC, and this super bantamweight belt, which brilliant Eric Morales vacated to move up to featherweight. Last weekend's victory over Kevin Kelly gave him the interim 9-stone crown, leaving the 8-stone-10 version up for grabs.
This is your dream, like the WBC belt. It's one of the best belts. And you look, Aguilar, Hearns, Tyson, all the champions have had it, and I'm going to get it.
Brodie could not have a harder challenge. He tackles another unbeaten prospect. Classy American Willie Jorrin has tremendous hand speed, a world-class trainer in Freddie Roach, and a fiery determination.
I put in 110%, and I plan on achieving my goal, like I said, and that's to win this world title. And like I said, it has my name on it, WBC, Willie's Boxing Crown.
It's his dream as well as my dream, but as I say, I think I'll be too strong. And you'll see on the night, I want this world title so bad, it means everything to me.
It will be very, very emotional when he comes out. Jim, has the education been the right one for a man about to take this biggest step?
Yeah, definitely, and I think the timing is right too. I mean, Michael was a kid who had to gain confidence. I think he's done that. He's been sensibly managed, but when I say that, I don't mean he's been wrapped in cotton wool. 10 of his last 11 fights have been title fights. He's been in tough fights. He's fought the best at domestic level, European level, Commonwealth level. He hasn't dodged anybody. He's been in tough fights. He's come out on top. So he should be in the dressing room now knowing, I can do the business here, so let's get out and get on with it.
Here's how both men plan to win this one. This is one I cannot wait for, Barry. But what can we expect from Jorrin?
What we can expect is he's a top-class operator. He's very clever. He's seen all this before. He's been dealing with Mexicans and tough Tex-Mex in America. He's got Freddie Roach in his corner. He doesn't handle slouches or guys that aren't good. He handles quality fighters. He's had many world champions. And he reckons this guy's going to be another one. He's seen what Brodie has had to offer. He thinks he's going to do it. He feels he fought tougher guys than Brodie before. But let's wait and see. Brodie's a big, strong guy. I hope he can get to him. I hope he didn't get caught early on. Remember the Simon Ramone fight where Brodie was hurt and stunned a few times. He's got to make sure not to allow this happen. To be physical with this guy, stay on top of him and force the fight.
Thank you, Barry. Another expert view from Spencer Oliver, former European champion with Adam.
Well, Spencer, two unbeaten fighters for Eric Morales' old title. England versus America. Doesn't get any better than this, does it?
No, I mean, both are desperate to win. When you've got that unbeaten record, that really does mean something, you know. This is going to be an excellent contest. Brodie, very strong, very persistent, keeps coming, switches well from body to head. You know, and Jorrin works well as well. Combination punches, works well 5 and 6 at a time and then moves out. And he can box and can fight. So Michael Brodie can't afford to start slowly. He must be on the ball from round one. We saw in his last fight against Ham, who was not a very big puncher.
He can be put down.
He can be put down. He can be caught. If that's the case here, if he gets caught early with Jorrin, Jorrin's a different class again, and he cannot afford that. You know, if he gets caught early, you know, Jorrin won't let him off the hook. So he must be on the ball from the beginning. But I spoke to Michael earlier. He was very up for the fight. You know, he's very focused. Probably the best I've seen him for a long time. He's a bit bored with the European title. So this is a big chance for him. And in his hometown, what a better place.
Thanks very much, Spencer.
I think they've said it all. The big fight's next. Superb lineup of live football for you on Sunday on Sky Sports. Midday, Sky Sports 2 from the First Division. Fulham against Barnsley, potential promotion chasers there. Sky Sports 1 from 3:30. In the Premiership, it's Derby County against Charlton, and there's interactive coverage on Sky Sports Extra. And from 6:30 on Sky Sports 1, we go back to Spain for Las Palmas against Alaves. All these games exclusively live only on Sky Sports. This is Manchester. And the city's hoping to salute a new world champion at bowlers tonight. The WBC World Super Bantamweight crown vacated by Eric Morales, opening the door for the home hero Michael Brodie. But is he ready? Here's John McDonald.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's the fight of the night, the main event. Please welcome to the ring now, from Sacramento, USA, Willie.
Here's the Mexican-American, Willie Jorrin, beaten in 26 fights with 12 knockouts. The word is that he is very, very fast indeed. I was talking to his Hollywood-based trainer, Freddie Roach, who used to handle Steve Collins last night, and he said to me that some of his skills were in the class of the featherweight legend, Willie Pep. And if that's right, that's a big, big shout, Glenn.
Well, that's a tremendous shout, if it is right. I'm sure Roach is going to say good things about his man. But, you know, we've seen little clips of him. We know he's a very good fighter. We know he looks so strong, so organized, puts his punches together very well indeed. So this is a class fight, a tough challenge for Michael Brodie. But, you know, he's got to try and do it.
He's already beaten some useful men. But like Brodie, untested really at top world level. I have to tell you, though, the Americans' camp are very, very confident indeed. They say that Jorrin will have too much for Brodie. We'll see. All his family are here, including his wife, and they expect it to be a coronation night, so this is no easy job for Michael Brodie. Thank you.
listen to that support for Michael Brodie. And tonight he gets the big treatment. Been won by stoppage. If he's not ready now, he never will be. And it would be a remarkable achievement for a boy who was brought up by his elder brother in one of the toughest parts of this city after the death of his mother. This morning, as always on a fight day, Michael went to his mother's graveside. Tonight, in her memory, he attempts to become champion of the world.
Well, he's come up the right way. He's done everything that's asked of him. He's won the British, Commonwealth and European, and now he's got his knife. For me, I think they've given him his best chance. They've done everything right. It's down to Brodie now. This is a fight. This is when he's got to try and pull it out. And this is where he needs to be at his very best.
Here's the tail of the tape for this fight. Brodie looking a little tense as well. He might do. Hope it doesn't affect his performance. The chance arriving late for Jorrin at the age of 30. Brodie, 26, ideal, really. Height, exactly the same. Reach, about the same. Both just about on the 8-stone, 10-pound super bantamweight limit. This is the division between bantamweight and featherweight. Brodie's debut 1994, Jorrin a year earlier. Very similar records, unbeaten in getting on for 30 fights apiece, almost identical number of rounds. Brodie seems to be the one with that extra bit of power, but you shouldn't underestimate that at Jorrin, I'm told, from the west coast of America.
Event. Ringside Boxing Promotions proudly presents the vacant WBC Super Bantamweight Championship of the World, sponsored here by Dunham Bookmakers, and live and exclusive here on Sky Sports. You've joined us for the very best ringside seat in the business. All the officials have been appointed by the World Boxing Council and the British Boxing Board of Control. Our matchmaker is Mr. Graham Lockwood of Skipton. The president of the World Boxing Council, Dr. Jose Suleiman, has appointed Signora Enza Giacoponi as the fight supervisor. The WBC vice president, our representative here at ringside from Spain, Señor Rubin Martinez. Our three scoring judges. From Italy, Franco Cimanali. From Belgium, Bob Logist. And from Mexico, Ray Solis. The timekeeper at the bell from the still city of Sheffield, Mr. Barry Pinder. And the referee in charge from London, England. And one of the leading referees in the world, Richie Davis. Well, they are the officials. Here are the contestants. Firstly, and introducing to you, he's fighting out of the red corner. He's wearing the white trunks trimmed with red and blue. Weighing in at 8 stone, 9 pounds and 15 ounces. Bringing an undefeated record, 26 contests, 26 wins, 12 inside the scheduled distance. Coming to the ring as the North American Boxing Federation Super Bantamweight Champion from the Gold Rush City of Sacramento, USA. Please welcome Willie Jorrin. And across the ring, fighting out of the blue corner, he's wearing the red, white, and blue trunks. He comes to the ring as the former undefeated British Commonwealth and European Super Bantamweight Champion. Please welcome the Pride of Manchester, Michael Brodie. Well, sports fans and Sky fans, let's get the action on then. 12 rounds of boxing for the Waker WBC Super Bantamweight Championship of the World. The referee gives his final instructions.
Your front page instructions in the dressing room. You can have good, clean contest. Obey my commands at all times. Make sure you can defend yourselves. Shake hands now. God bless you both.
All set to go then. This title vacated by Eric Morales after his move to featherweight, then held in the past by greats like Wilfredo Gomez, Jeff Fennec, Kennedy McKinney, Marco Antonio Pereira, all champions at this weight in the past. So it's quite a tradition that these two are joining here. Michael Brodie from Manchester in the red, white and blue trunks. How good is this Willie Jorrin? There's a lot of stories about him. Let's just see. Brodie, renowned for his body punching and pressure. Home advantage here. Brodie, WBC number one, and Jorrin, number two, fighting for the vacant championship. Clash of heads early on, which was the referee was a little worried about.
Well, Brodie will be looking for a good start. He needs to try and dominate, centre ring, just stamp his authority right from the beginning, use his jab well, and just be careful with the defence because Jorrin has got very fast hands.
He's known to be quite slick, but not necessarily a mover, Jorrin. He's there for a fight if you want one, and that was a pretty decent-looking left hook that he threw. Phenomenal speed, they say. Both of them unbeaten, remember. Something has to give here. Brodie starting an 11-8 on favourite with the bookmakers, largely because his manager, Jack Trickett, has put £10,000 on him. He can afford it.
Well, he's done a very good job, Jack Trickett. He's worked his way up with his man. He's been patient. He's waited till he thinks he's right and the right opportunity's there.
There's those fast hands of Horry getting through with two to the head. They'll have both watched each other an awful lot on video, but that's one thing. Actually facing the guy in the flesh is another.
Well, just in the corner standing beforehand, but he looked a bit nervous, but you know, he started strongly and he looks confident now.
He seemed to loosen up when he heard the huge ovation he got when he was announced, it seemed to me. I was worried about him until that point. He looked very tense.
That's right. This is a massive moment for Michael Brodie, fighting for such a great honour as this.
Brodie was down in the first round of his last European title defence. He went on to win impressively in four rounds against Mustafa Hami. But it was a bit of a worry. Body shots this time from Jorrin. Some light on his feet and looking bullish. The camp have been bullish all week.
Brodie doing the right thing in the opening round, pushing forward. You're not allowing Jorrin to get too confident. And this is a steady start for Brodie.
Not too much in that first round.
On the 3rd of March last year, the Powell family were woken by their smoke alarm. Mrs. Powell escaped with the baby. Her husband went to get their little girls. Finding their beds empty, he fought his way outside. The girls weren't there. He tried to return but was beaten back by flames. I found their bodies in the wardrobe, where they'd hidden.
Use this leaflet. Make your plan. Get out alive.
Well, there's a look at some of these great world super bantamweight champions, and that is a great list. It's a comparatively new division in history, but my goodness me, it's making up for lost time. Marco Antonio Pereira, by the way, still holding the WBO title, even though he lost to Eric Morales. A bit of ridiculous that, really, the WBO doing that, but they did. There you go, sign of the times. Here's the second round, due to go 12, of course, for the WBC's Super Bantamweight Championship at 8 stone 10 pounds. Michael Brodie of Manchester in the multicoloured shorts, looking to become only the fourth world champion in history from this city. Joe Parker, Jackie Brown, and more recently the cruiserweight Carl Thompson, the others. Very, very tight, that opening round.
Yes, it was tight. Difficult to decide between Jorrin, a couple of good body punches, and Brodie just a textbook jab.
Good right hand, got through there. There's some blood around near the ear, the left ear of Brodie. Now, where's that coming from? It's coming, I tell you what, from a cut on the forehead of Jorrin. There's obviously been some kind of clash of heads, you'd think, there. This has to go four completed rounds, otherwise it'll be a technical draw. They don't go to the scorecards until that point, but I don't think the cuts are bad enough to be thinking of that kind of ending.
Well, you wouldn't think so if they're on the head, but still, you know, they are getting in close now. The punches are starting to land, and you know, the crowd's getting very excited by all this.
Great atmosphere in this bowlers arena just down the road from Manchester United's football ground. Intense support for Brodie. Can he do it? A week ahead of his marriage, by the way. He won't be thinking about that at the moment. His bride-to-be Don up somewhere in the crowd. Fast hands of Jorrin. Getting through now once or twice to the head. Brodie's going to have to use plenty of head movement, rolling and dipping on the way in.
But Brodie certainly not phased. He's coming forward. He's trying to hunt Jorrin down, look for the openings.
Again, the two-punch combination from Jorrin. He's just being a bit outspeeded in this round, Brodie.
Yes, he is fast with that 1-2, that straight left, right through the middle. The right hand especially comes through. Very crisp, very fast.
I don't think Brodie's actually got any cut. There's just some blood that's smeared off the forehead of Jorrin. The cut is, well, actually under his hair almost. Looking a very useful operator though, the Californian.
The clash of heads, and Brodie was pretty lucky himself there. He got a bit of damage to the ear. Jorrin got a cut which bled quite a bit higher up on the head, but definitely heads coming close there and clashing together.
It's not really in a position though that they'd worry about too much, is it?
It's not, but I think you've got to be aware of them clashing heads again. And there's the fast hands, the good reflexes, and especially that 1-2, which is a good combination of Jorrin's.
Freddie Roach, who used to be with Steve Collins, is the lead man in the corner with John Cazares. Steve Farrand is on the cuts. He's already in work for Willie Jorrin. His real name is Guillermo, but the nuns at his Catholic school couldn't pronounce that, and it came out as Willie somehow. That's the story anyway. Not too many boxes were taught by nuns.
I was, for a little while,
yeah. Doesn't show. Third round, Jorrin with a lot of grease where that cut developed in the previous round. Now Brodie's got to overcome this slight disadvantage he has with speed, and maybe the answer there is
body shots. Maybe the later part of the fight might be more Brodie's territory. Maybe.
Yeah, I think that's what he's got to look for, Ian. I think he's not the body punches too early, although he was finding him there, but I think he's got to keep a steady pressure on Jorrin and hope that it'll all tell later on.
There were the first trademark body shots from Brodie, and Jorrin just indicating he thought one of them had gone a little bit low. I didn't think it had, actually. This is better from Brodie, starting now to unload with some of the punches that have got him this far. Can he build on that?
Well, Brodie managing to keep his hands up nice and high. Good rhythm going in. He needs to carry on with that. He's going to need concentration throughout.
Lovely straight right from Jorrin. They look pretty evenly matched so far. Brodie does well with the left hook. Jorrin looks a bit of a tough man. I think he's only been on the floor once in his career. Product of the West Coast gyms. He was among the top three amateurs in the country, in the United States, around 1992, the sort of Oscar De La Hoya period. Good shots again there by Brodie.
Brodie looking more firm in what he does, letting his punches go sharp, and this looks a good round for Brodie.
It's loosening up, isn't he?
Yes, I mean, he's done that in several of his last fights. Just as the rounds have gone on, he's got better and better, and this is what he's going to be hoping to do in this fight.
Has to watch those straight rights from Jorrin, but Brodie's outworked the Californian in this round, I think. Well done, Michael Brodie. You came back well then.
There's more live cricket for you here, Sky Sports Sunday from 12:30 on Sky Sports 3. It's Notts against Glamorgan in the National League game. And for digital viewers, interactive coverage available as well. Exclusively live Sunday from 12:30 on Sky Sports 3. Back live here in Manchester. And my, this is exciting.
Yeah, thanks, Paul. Here we go. Here's the next chapter, round 4 for the WBC's Super Bantamweight title. This is a real title and two guys who've earned the chance. Multicoloured trunks, remember. Manchester's Michael Brodie had a good third round. Jorrin's work rate seemed to drop off, maybe encouragingly for Brodie in that last session.
And as you said, Ian, Brodie loosening up, bringing that left hook to the body in more and more. That's a good punch, and that's going to just weaken Jorrin and maybe stop his speedy punches going in.
Brodie has done 96 rounds of sparring for this fight, and a lot of running up some very steep hills. Ooh, look at this from Jorrin, letting go with a right uppercut there. It didn't quite land flush. This might be one of those battles that seesaws as it goes through, and we could end up with something like a close points decision. But let's not get ahead of ourselves.
Well, like you said, Ian, these are two good fighters challenging for a bona fide title. Two guys who's really worked their way and are deserved to be in this position.
Blocked the shot, Brodie. Now that's just a slip from Brodie there. No knockdown. And Richie Davis, the London cab driver who's refereeing this, the seventh world try to fight as a referee. He's had a few more as a judge, mind you. Just a little nick on the cheekbones as well for Jorrin. Brodie's defense pretty good. And he gets him with a nice clubbing right hand as well. Is this graduation night for Michael Brodie? Started boxing after a fight
during a football match that he was playing in. Somebody said, you're a bit useful, get down the gym. And it's ended up here.
One of the good points for Brodie is that Jorrin, you know, as he goes on, his hands are getting lower and lower. And that just gives Brodie a better chance. Brodie's hands nice and tight. Good defence.
Thought about switch hitting for a moment there, Jorrin. But this is quite a good spell in the fight for Brodie here. After one or two discouraging signs in the second.
In the world of fashion, good taste has always been in. No wonder they can't keep their hands off Uncle Ben's Rispinos. Like crispy rice bites in apple cinnamon, chocolate and caramel. New Rispinos from Uncle Ben's. The taste is in, the fat's out.
Oi! Come back and finish me off, you wimp! What's the matter? Too spicy for ya!
Pepper Army. It's a bit of an animal.
This time next Saturday, the lady on the far side there, Donna, in the same outfit Brodie's wearing tonight, will be his wife. She must be a bag of nerves watching this in the bar on a monitor.
I'm sure he is, she is, but she is managing to watch for the time being. So she's been pretty brave.
I think she comes to all his fights. Here we go in the fifth round. I've got Brodie just a point ahead now. The challenger, the one in the white trunks, if you still need the identification.
That's a nice combination for Brodie, just getting off first. He's got to keep busy, use that jab, and then keep bringing in those combinations.
Look like good shots from Jorrin there. For wins, Jorrin, beating people like Enrique Jupiter, the former Mexican champion who's fringe world class, Edgar Garcia, who beat Augie Sanchez. Okay. This will be his hardest fight.
It's good work for Brodie, nice attack he's putting Jorrin under here.
Yeah, the body shots, and they're the kind of shots that could take something out of Jorrin. If Brodie manages to land with them with regularity. His every punch has been cheered to the echo around this crowded arena. He's developed a nice rhythm now, Brodie. That's a good right hand. We seem to trouble Jorrin for a moment, but he wants to hold on significantly after it landed.
Yes, he did. Brodie boxing with a better textbook style, working well behind the jab, mixing it up, and it's Jorrin whose style just coming apart somewhat.
Just looking more open, Jorrin, and Brodie not letting him get off first with his shots. The result of that is the American is finding it harder to slip into his rhythm. Looks like he's done his homework and thoroughly, Brodie, so far anyway. Long way to go yet.
Well, his commitment looks very strong, his resolve. You know, he's really doing well here.
That was a quick and flashy combination, wasn't it, from Jorrin, though?
Well, he's going to need all his concentration, Brodie. He needs to keep that. He really can't relax in 1 second during this fight.
Well, he's lifting his arms to the crowd. That may be a little psychological message to the judges here. And he's breathing quite heavily. I think one of those body shots definitely troubled him. Jorrin, at the moment, is looking like the fighter who's having the more difficulty imposing himself here.
That's right, little clips you've seen him before. He looked strong, looked as if he kept his style together well. But here he just seems to be failing a bit. Hands are coming down, defences are falling apart a bit, and Brodie working well, the body and head.
By the way, the judges tonight from Italy, Belgium and from Mexico, Ray Solis is 77 and goes back as far as being a judge for Sugar Ray Leonard and Wilfredo Benitez in 79. That's amazing, isn't it?
It's unbelievable.
He also did Morris Hope, and he also judged Wilfredo Gomez.
Well, he knows his boxing. He's been around for a few good fights.
Not to mention Colin Jones, Milton McCrory first fight in Reno. That ages me, because I was at it. A draw to. Sixth round. Multicolored trunks, remember, Michael Brodie. Who's made good money out of the European title, £40,000-£50,000 a time. Got a posh new house out of it all. Now he wants even more with a world championship.
May have to try something different soon, because they're moving away, you know, flicking out the jab and looking for the right counter has not really worked, so he's gonna have to try and bring something else into play.
And at the moment, I'll mention the word again, rhythm. That's what Brodie seems to have. He's getting caught with the odd one, like that one just now. Looking strong too. Getting in with the jab and then working one or two combinations off that.
Jorrin looking to try and take the fight to Brodie for the first time. He never really has tried to push Brodie onto the back foot.
Willie always tried to lift Michael Brodie off his feet there, bending down. A little sign that Jorrin is frustrated that.
And Brodie straight in, good double left hook, body head, keeping the pressure on.
Brodie's outworking him, and I'd have to say it, outboxing him at the moment. It's looking good at the moment for the British fighter. But this is the sixth round, and the distance is 12. Fight we expected. I expected Jorrin to be a little more elusive than this. His own defense looks a shade leaky, doesn't it?
It's very sloppy. Hands are too low, moving around, and you're not covering up as Brodie comes forward. Brodie doing it very well, hands up nice and tight, keeping cool whenever he is under a little bit of pressure.
Brodie again for me, and I think he's just opening up a little lead at the moment. They're showing out Adam Smith, who has with him the former European champion at this weight, Spencer Oliver.
Thanks, Ian. The hands went up for Michael Brodie after a nervous start. He's really relaxed and boxing well, isn't he?
Yeah, he looked very nervous at the start. The first couple of rounds, you know, he was missing, he was out of range, he looked very nervous. Jorrin looked the more focused of the two. And now he's settled down, he's excellent, he's buzzing, you can see the confidence is oozing out of him now, and he looks like he's climbing on top. I've got him a couple of points in front.
Jorrin cannot get to grips with this now. What has he got to do?
Jorrin really has got to start putting his punches together. We've seen him previously in previous fights, putting together in fours and fives. He's looking for the single shot, so he's got to start putting the shots together and leading off first. He's not doing enough work himself.
So far, so good for Michael Brodie.
Yeah, Michael Brodie, I've just got him edging in front now. He's just got to keep at it.
Thanks a lot, Spencer. Back to you, Ian.
Ray Farrell leading the team in the corner for Michael Brodie, and they've been saying all week his preparation right on the button for this. But confident noises, it must be said, from both camps. into the second half of the fight. Brodie knows there's still a lot of work to do. Let's have a look at McCrory's scorecard so far.
Yeah, Brodie, you know, same as you in pulling away. I've got it by a bigger margin, 3 points for me, 59-56 in Brodie's favour.
No, that's how I've got it as well, 3 points. Last three rounds to Brodie. He's looking razor sharp at the moment, Brodie. And here you're seeing the payoff for the patient build-up he's had. It's not too early for him to get this chance. All that experience at European level has prepared him for this night.
Well, that's what it's all about. It's all about, you know, talking about getting to a world title, but it's about being equipped when you get there. It's about doing the work of, you're having the experience under your belt, and that's what Brodie's got.
And as I was saying earlier, it would be a tremendous achievement if Brodie can do it for a fellow who didn't have too much going for him earlier on in life. Without getting cliched around it, boxing has turned this young fellow's life around. And his dedication to it as well, not to mention the skill. Roach's comparisons between Jorrin and Willie Pep are looking a little far-fetched, to put it mildly, at the moment.
Yeah, yes, just a little. Okay, nothing away from Brodie. This is a good performance from him. He's doing everything right, and he's doing it very confidently.
Worth stressing again that one punch, just one punch, could turn things on their head.
As we saw not so long ago on Monday.
Absolutely, in that World Bantamweight title fight, also in Manchester. Looking to go to the body now, more Jorrin.
Yeah, we looked a solid right hand to the body going in, just brought a flinch from Brodie.
Hands low, they have been for two or three rounds now from Jorrin. Glass is there, the manager of Michael Brodie, and I must say he's looked after him very, very well indeed. He's got a £10,000 bet on Michael tonight.
Well, his money's looking good at the moment, but as we said earlier, it just takes one punch. But this is a good performance from Michael Brodie, doing everything right, looking confident, looking strong, looking like he has total belief in himself.
Here's round eight, a quietish seven. Tending to box in flurries. He needs a big round, doesn't he, looking at it from his perspective?
Yes, he needs something very big. He's got to pull a punch out. He's got to try and take the play away from Brodie somehow, because Brodie's just rolling on with a nice rhythm and just picking up the points.
He said before leaving America, Willie Jorrin, that he expected he'd have to knock out Brodie to win. He certainly can't expect any favours from the judges fighting in Brodie's home city. That's just the way it is in boxing. Mind you, the way it's going, Brodie won't need many favours.
Well, does Jorrin have anything different? Can he pull anything out? As yet, he's not showing that he can. He hasn't really tried that much different.
Yes, good work in clusters from Brodie this time. Jorrin, his tactics now, looking to try and rough up Brodie, close in, punish him to the body. But he has the look at the moment, Jorrin, of a fighter who's just run out of ideas at this stage of the fight. Brodie just seems to have a few too many skills for him at the moment.
Yes, he does. He just seems like he has the measure of him. Even though Horan's trying to push forward, Brodie's coping with it.
There's a clash of heads there. That was what Richie Davis was worried about. I don't want any more of that. Good refereeing from Richie Davis. Quickly on the case. Talks a lot for the fighters in there. Makes them know who's in charge. Be a little slippery patch on the ring on that far side. Brodie just slipped on it again there earlier. He slipped up and went down from it. Not a knockdown, of course.
There's a nice uppercut in there from Brodie and the right hand. Still picking the better punches. Still, you know, he's the sharper. He's the one with more ideas.
Anything to upset Brodie's control and rhythm. The battle plan for Jorrin, no doubt about it, is body shots.
Yeah, he was looking for two good left hooks there, but Brodie had the elbow down, caught them on the arm.
Oh, punches from both of them after the bell. And oh, that's good sportsmanship. Brodie made a point of going over to touch gloves at the end of the round, as if to say, look, no hard feelings. That's amazing to see, really, isn't it?
In the middle
of a battle
is.
Like this.
It is. They've got respect for each other. It's a good fight. They just got a bit carried away. And you know, Brodie gave him a one to the body, and Jorrin come back with a clip with his right hand. Brodie quickly apologised. He knew who was to blame. And, you know, that's nice to see.
Yeah, without getting too soft and sentimental about it, Brodie is a fighter with a quite sensitive side. Jack Trickett, his manager, says he's almost too nice to be a boxer. He's disguising it well in there tonight, isn't he?
He is a nice guy, but some good shots we're seeing here from Brodie, picking the punch as well. Look at that, the uppercut, and then the right hand over the top. And he's just, you know, he's full of ideas. He's really bustling with confidence. You can see it just coming out of him.
Ninth round, getting towards the closing stages of this one now, the last third of the fight. Definitely a case of so far, so good for Michael Brodie, who I would think must be ahead on the scorecards. I have to say, I've been a bit disappointed in Jorrin after the things I'd heard.
Yes, we heard some good things, but yeah, you can be disappointed in him, but you've got to be very pleased with Brodie, because Brodie's not allowing him to show good things. You know, maybe if Brodie hadn't been on this sort of form, Jorrin might have looked amazing, but Brodie, you know, he's boxing so well, doing everything to plan.
Yeah, absolutely. Sometimes can only fight as well as the other guy lets you. Body shot was a good one from Brodie, and he's rather walking onto some shots in there, you know, Jorrin. Listen to the crowd, there's a great right uppercut too from Brodie.
Yeah, I think, Ian, with the opponent, with the fight, this is the best I've ever seen Michael Brodie. He really is on good form.
Just a reminder, he's in with a guy too who's got a record of 26 wins and no defeats in there. There's more blood around the face of Jorrin. Had that cut on the forehead earlier, there might be something else. I'll take a closer look when we can. But he's back to us at the moment.
But Brodie just non-stop work here, not giving Jorrin a chance to get his punches off. This is great work. The crowd appreciating it.
It's coming close together there, but Brodie continues to dictate terms here. And as far as he's concerned, none of this is a matter for negotiation. Looked a very rounded, mature, complete pro in there, hasn't he, Brodie, tonight?
Yes, he's boxing with a man, like a man with an air of confidence that, you know, he knows his destiny, he knows what he can do. I spoke to Jack Trickett a couple of times this week, and he said, You know, Jack's had his reservations. He knows it's all down to Michael, but he said Michael is so confident. He really knows he can do it.
Good exchanges here. A bit more success for Horry. Absolutely nothing can ever be taken for granted, of course. I think we'll become increasingly desperate as things go on, and that could make him even more dangerous. But I think Brodie's pulling away and is in a very handy lead. Now, I wonder what Jack Trickett, Brodie's manager, is making of it. We can find out now. He's with Adam.
Well, Jack, the £10,000 bet looks pretty safe at the minute.
It does, but we'll wait till the end. But I told you he's a champion. I've always told you he's world-class, and he is. He's proved it tonight, hasn't he? This kid's a great fighter. My kid's knocking the shit out of him.
What are they saying in the corner here and around? Do they think he's well in front, four or five rounds?
We think we're four or five rounds up. I don't think there's any doubt in it, do you? He's forced to fight all the way. He's hitting with combinations. But he's one tough guy, isn't he?
Just got to be careful in the last three.
That's it. I think really he should be standing off boxing a bit more now. I think he can coast it on the boxing now. I don't think he's even reason to go in and war.
Thanks a lot, Jack.
I think there was our entry for politically incorrect broadcast of the year, I think.
You can tell he's getting a bit excited, can't you?
We are live, as you might have gathered. 10th round. Multicoloured trunks, Michael Brodie. And there'll be some party up here, I tell you, if he wins this. But do not discount this tough Californian who's never tasted defeat yet. And he's used to long-distance fight, 8 10-rounders, 1 12-rounder. Brodie, stamina shouldn't be a problem for him either. And they've both, of course, prepared meticulously for this.
Well, Freddie Roach in Horan's corner will not be mincing his words. He'll be starting to tell his man, you're getting beat, you've got to stop this guy. So watch, this is where Horan might get dangerous when desperation starts creeping in.
That was a good-looking right hand from him, too. He's going to, I think, try to wade forward and almost walk through Brodie if he can. Brodie's a good student of the business. He's good at predicting the way other people's fights will go. So I think there's a good strategic brain at work there.
Well, as long as he doesn't start, believing in everything at this moment, he's got to just keep focused, keep his concentration going till the final bell.
Two nice short little hooks from Brodie. I had him 6 points up going into this round.
I've got Brodie 5 points up.
Horrin didn't need the knockout before. I think he might do now. And I think if Brodie does do it, it'll be a win that will be celebrated throughout British boxing. He's a very popular little fighter.
Couple of good punches going in there from Horan. Brodie just standing for them. Got to keep the hands up.
Horan going for broke with some of these now. Setting his feet, and he's got Brodie going. His gum shields come out. He was hurt by those hooks, and here's a crisis for Michael Brodie with 25 seconds left in the 10th round. Horan gets through. The gum shield is still out. The referee, when there's a lull, should give Brodie a chance to get the gun shield back in, which he does, and he needs this little break. He's come at the wrong time for Horan, who just had him going for a moment there. Well, we're only in the 10th, and that's taken something out of Brodie. This is no formality now.
No, that will give Horan a lot of confidence.
Oh, right hand, and that's a knockdown. He touched down. A bad 10th round. Is it all going to fall apart for Michael Brodie? Late on here, he needs this bell, he needs the bell. They touch gloves, 10-8 round, that for Willie Horan. Oh dear, alarm bells flashing.
Well, you know, this is what happens when a fighter gets desperate. And you know, I said that you know, that was going to happen. He is get desperate, and he just started to unload. And then the punches went in, the hands come down a little bit from Brodie, and there were some big, solid punches going in.
There's the gum shield going out. And he took a count as well. He still had enough about him to send a little sign message to the corner there.
Well, he maybe had enough about him to spit the gum shield out and try and buy a bit of time, I'm not sure.
Well, I don't know. I think he was really serious. I think he genuinely was knocked out.
Well, it was a good shot, but he did seem to have still a bit about him.
Good bit of gamesmanship if he did that. Terrific. Two rounds to go. Oh, this is exciting now. WBC's Super Bantamweight Championship, the one vacated by the top-class Mexican, Eric Morales. And big hooks again from Jorrin. Brodie doesn't want to be taking these early in the round, or come to that even later on. Jorrin, I think, is going for broke now. He knows he has to rescue this on the scorecard. He can't win on points. I think the corner have told him that. You've got to knock him out, they're telling him.
But Brodie showing good punches, coming back, really throwing in a couple of hard ones to the body. He needs to stop this little rise in confidence from Jorrin.
Yes, he needs to throw a couple of punches that would be big reminders to Jorrin on the way in. The danger for Jorrin is he could walk onto one. And can he sustain this kind of rally this late on, having taken a fair few himself? All these fans in Manchester just praying that the crisis is past for Michael Brodie.
Well, there's a good chopping right hand and a nice body punch going in from Brodie. But Jorrin just loading up, he's just looking to catch Brodie on the counter with a big punch.
He's in search of the equaliser. There's a cut now for Jorrin by his left eye. I don't think it's going to matter too much. This is late in the fight now, halfway through the 11th, just past that point. This is built up to a real crescendo. What a night here in Manchester. Brodie, great shot, left hook, gives ground Jorrin that time, hurt by that one.
Well, has the danger passed for Brodie? Is he just starting to tire Jorrin?
Just goes to show you though what we were saying, you can never take it for granted. It's a bit like a wounded tiger in there at the moment, Jorrin. Has he just punched himself out for the time being? Donna, the bride-to-be of Michael Brodie, is now right by the ringside watching.
Well, I think the excitement's been all too much for her. She feels she's trying to get in there at the moment.
Will he go to the altar as WBC world champion, Michael Brodie? Brodie's come back well in this round. He's starting to look strong again. You wondered if his world was falling apart in the 10th, but that was better in the 11th. There is Donna. Oh dear, this must be agony for her, mustn't it?
Very, very hard. You know, she knows he's so close. I think everybody knows he's so close, and you know, everybody's just willing for him to get through these final three rounds.
And she knows enough about boxing not to be too worried about the wedding photos either.
I don't think that's the last thing on their mind.
There's the two fighters. You can see the cut by the side of the left eye of Jorrin. Punches landed so far. Brodie, big advantage. That's how we're seeing it on the scorecards too. I think Brodie came back to nick that round, Glenn, 11.
I think he did. I'd give it to Brodie. I just think he was a bit busier. He's in a handy lead on my card, 4 points still, even after that bad 10.
And I've got it by 5. We're coming up to the final 3 minutes. Is this the coronation night for Michael Brodie? He might be 3 minutes away here. Can see the finishing tape. Horrin's corner will have told him, you've just got to go for broke completely. They must know the way that the scorecards are looking, unless they've been wearing blindfolds. He just has to hold it together here. Good right hand to the body. It's been a super performance, this, from Brodie. A night that all the years of hard work and toil and hopes and frustrations could come to fruition for him. And now he's a little over 2 minutes away. No alarms as yet in this last round. With the storm clouds appear to have disappeared over the horizon. He just hopes there's not another one coming. That's a little straight left hand that just caught Horrin off balance, I thought, more than anything.
Yes, he was just moving in and he slipped, his legs severed, and he's just caught with a little left hand. I don't think there was any real danger in that.
Yeah, just looked like Bambi on ice, didn't he, for a moment there. Horrin looking tired and holding on now. Has he got any more as we approach the final minute? Uppercut from him. Look at this again. Great right hand, too. And another one. Snarling defiance here, Willie Horrin. Well, it's been a privilege and a pleasure to cover the rise and rise of Michael Brodie. He's had a few off nights along the way, but this may be the greatest night of all. 3/4 of a minute away from becoming WBC Super Bantamweight champion. We think, surely, unless Horrin has got one jackpot piece of dramatics left in him.
Well, he's gutsy, he's brave, he's trying right to the end, Horrin. He's trying to find a way, trying to find a punch that will bring him the title. But at this moment, it just looks like everything Michael Brodie does is right.
Listen to this crowd. And I know they're scored up here in Manchester as Brodie has to take body shots from the Californian. Here's the countdown, top left of your picture. 10 seconds to go. We have Brodie in a big lead on our scorecards. We think the judges would have it the same way, till you'll hear the bell any moment, and all hell will break loose here. It's over. It goes to the scorecards. But for some, the celebrations have already started, not least bride-to-be Donna. Brodie's being lifted aloft, look at this. The American's corner are lifting him up too. Bob Logis, the Belgian judge, gives us a wry smile without revealing his scorecard. And he disappears into the distance. It all has to be handed to the supervisor. We have to wait for it officially. Matching him and hers outfits. Few tears in there, tears of emotion at the moment. But I've got Brodie winning that fight by a 6-point margin on my card.
Well, I've got a bit closer than you, and I just got a 3-point margin, but a tremendous performance from Michael Brodie. Kept it together so well, even in the 10th, you know, when he had to come back, when he took some good shots, showed tremendous character. And for me, you know, he's a good winner.
Correction to my scorecard, by 4, just on another piece of mathematics. By 4 to Brodie.
Get it a bit better than you, Ian.
But that's a clear margin, though, isn't it?
Oh, yes.
Unless we, you know, the judges are seeing something completely different. And I don't think, these are experienced judges, Logist and Solis. I don't know the other guy, Ciminali from Italy, too well. But those two, and here we are in Manchester, without counting too many chickens, I would be amazed if Brodie doesn't get this.
Yep, but we've been amazed before, Ian.
Yeah, we have.
on a few occasions,
yes,
haven't we?
Not least in New York on the night of Lennox Lewis, Evander Holyfield.
That's right. So, I mean, it just looks he's a clear winner. It looks as if he's done the best work. The camp seem to be happy, but I mean, they'll not be truly happy until they've got them scorecards.
Here's what the computer says. Brodie landed 2-2-1. Jorrin 142, and the better success rate from Brodie 2. It's a good fight with its dramatic moments, notably the 10th, when it looked like Jorrin might turn it all around. The McCrory scorecard by 3 points to Michael Brodie. And I had it by 4.
Well, I always worry when they take a long time with these cards. You know, it never fills me with any sort of confidence. And they're taking quite a while again.
I think they're just making sure they get it absolutely spot on. I think we're ready for the announcement now. John McDonald is up there. Let's get the decision now. And it may be a magic moment, this, for Brodie, let's hope. Or let's hope it is, anyway. Here we go.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 12 rounds of boxing, we have a majority decision. Judge Bob Lodges scores the contest 114-114, a draw. Judge Franco Gimanali has scored the contest 112-115. Ray Solis, 112-116. Your winner and the new WBC Bantamweight Champion of the World from Sacramento, USA!
Well, Jorrin has got it. That is unbelievable. That is unbelievable. I am stunned by that. Brodie is stunned. Nobody in this arena can believe it. What on earth was going on there?
Well, you look at the faces, look at the faces of the people. They are mystified, absolutely stunned by that decision. And I mean, we are. That is ridiculous. You said they might be amazed, and you just you just never know in this game. That to me is a terrible, terrible decision.
It's absolutely, well, to use the old phrase, it has absolutely stunk the place out. Brodie won that fight.
Absolutely, absolutely. He was the boss from the beginning to the end. He came out a clear winner, and that is criminal.
Absolutely bizarre. We do not need this as well in boxing. There have been far too many of these contentious decision. I'm looking around for anybody who thought that Willie Jorrin won that fight. Anybody around here looking? No way, says sponsor Oliver. Four rounds he has it. Adam Smith, my colleague, by 3 to Brodie. I'm at a loss to explain that one. Doesn't matter how long you watch this sport, it continues to leave you absolutely flabbergasted. I'd say Michael Brodie, and we're not being overly patriotic here, has been robbed there.
Yeah, but Ian, the game has enough knockers, you know, about the sport itself. Without that sort of thing happening, it really is, it's terribly out of order.